tell me about getting in science and...
I could start saying a little bit about how I got interested in the sciences. And of course, it's, that would be maybe too personal for interest, but it puts in perspective what brought me into catalysis and things like that. you see, my family was, to a large extent, very much involved in the sciences, in engineering and in the sciences. And my grandfather, who died in 1936, meaning years after I had started, and whom I knew very, very well, and I was very close to him, he was a chemist. And he did his work in the 60s, 70s, and 80s in 60 and so on. And a lot of the work he did in France, he got very close friends of the scientists in, on the continent at this time. Liebig was a close friend of his. Pasteur was a close friend, and many others. He was later credited for being one of the founders of modern crystallography. And actually, in England, every fifth year, for many, many years, they had a meeting to honor my grandfather. And of course, this involved the two Bracks, mm-hmm. who were also very close friends. And my grandfather's interest in the sciences, as I could, when I grew up, discuss with him, was very much focused on creating new understanding, new knowledge. Nevertheless, to a certain extent, he could also use this for some business purposes, which helped to make him a wealthy man. But still, he was interested in new knowledge. It was of the generation where the people did also the experimental work themselves by their own means. Or do you tape this? Do you tape all this?
Mm-hmm.
That's fine. Okay.
Yes.
When he died, we found a lot of the very primitive equipment he had made for making his table of crystallographic data, which for many years was one of the reference works in crystallography. It's amazing how exact his measurements were, and measurements of others at the same time. One other that I can't help thinking about was Liebig, mm-hmm. his extraordinary accuracy and extraordinary experimental capacity. Now, my grandfather was interested in understanding how, from crystallographic data, you could learn something about how there were families of components of atoms, And if you go back to the 1860s and so on, of course, one knew very little. Mendeleev had not finished his work to create the atomic table. Part of that work, of course, was based on exact identification of parameters for materials, crystals, and so on. And if you took, for instance, salt, special salt, and studied the crystallography of these salts, you would see how they fell into families. For instance, the magnesium, barium, strontium family, and so on. My grandfather was involved and interested in this. As a matter of fact, he was created a good friendship with a Russian group, and his studies, which were put into his thesis, concerned the saline salt, saline salt, what do you say, the selenic acid salt. And it is very clear from this how already there you can see the structure of families, and eventually you can see how the vast amount of work that was done by so many people could be condensed into the periodic table of Mendeleev. I thought that was very interesting. I like very much to follow this line of thought of coming from parameters of the outer big macroscopic crystals to an understanding of the structure of what maybe today you can permit yourself to call the atomic structure. Therefore, I got interested as a young chap in understanding physics and chemistry in this very beautiful combination that you could find in the study of crystals relating different chemicals, atoms, to each other by physical means. Now, I'm saying all this because, in a way, many of those people who in the early last century started thinking about catalysis, material science, and so on, they had this interest in, had this background in the knowledge of the interaction between studies of macroscopic, because that was what you had at the time, studies of crystals and chemistry. Obviously, the advent of X-ray analysis, Bragg Senior's work, followed up by Bragg Junior, and many others, what you can say, fantastic step in coming from the, shall we say, the crystallography, the macroscopic examination, into a method that allowed you an insight into the real material, into the solid state physics, into how you could relate the rather primitive work of crystallography to X-ray work. Now, I'm saying this because it's very much in the in my personal background, but of course also very much in the background of those others who worked with the catalysis. then another thing that gave me some sort of background was a close family relations with the Norwegians who created Norsk Hydro. And Birkeland and Eide were friends of my father's, his family, and therefore at an early time I learned about this for a young chap enormously impressive work done there. And then during my last years in school, during my study years, we also, so in the family, for different reasons, had close connections with people in science in Germany. Actually, as a young chap, I got to know through German friends of ours, many of the scientists, visiting families. I could go and spend my Easter holidays and so on with. I actually met Einstein. I never got to know him. I met him, saw him as a 16, 18 year old boy. And what impressed me there when I had to decide what I would study was, of course, the enormous progress made in synthesis, not the least in Germany, but to a certain extent we forget that much of what we call the German synthetic industry also had owed much to what was done elsewhere, both in England and in France, and in Russia. Now, what impressed me was the way in which they worked in Germany. During my early study years, we had an opportunity to follow what they did there, both for good reasons, but also for bad reasons, because the Nazi Germany, which of course was dominating it during my study years in the early 30s, wanted to impress non-German university students and so on by all sorts of seminars they were invited to visit to see how good they were. And this brought us to visit German research labs in the IT Farben, similar companies, smaller companies. And what impressed me was that they did not too much work in ex priori, but that they did almost matrix-oriented parameter studies. You might say that the research sections which I had expected would be very much oriented towards fundamental studies, from a huge multi-kitchen arranged in a sequence from a professor, 10 sub-professors, 100 program managers, and all that in order to cover as large a parameter area as possible. That impressed me, I would say, negatively, and reinforced my thinking that it would be possible to derive knowledge. And at the time, I was not thinking in industrially useful business knowledge, mm-hmm. I was thinking in knowledge, in terms of new knowledge about the sciences, or if you be sentimental, think like the young people thought at the time about nature. I thought that this multi-matrix kitchen parameter study was not something which was attractive to me, and to the contrary, I thought it might be possible to come to a situation where you could derive knowledge from more fundamental studies. And then when I could start studying, are we running out of time?
No, not plenty of time.
Then when I started studying, I wanted very much to study chemistry, but I wanted to try and learn to what extent physical knowledge of physics could be useful for understanding of chemistry. Therefore, most of my time during my study years, I spent in studying physics. And as I said, I don't know where you were at the dinner yesterday.
No.
I said at the dinner yesterday, we had some, I said something about this. Now, the situation was that if you were interested in chemistry the way my interest had developed, as I explained, then the first thing you ask yourself is, what physics can you throw after chemical problems, whether material science, which I personally consider part of chemistry, and or catalysis, which I thought was very fascinating, or processes, chemical conversions. What sort of physics could you throw after these problems to understand them in depth? And of course, we were all enormously impressed by the progress in theoretical physics, all of us. When I went to study and was accepted at Bohr's Institute, in a way you can see we were very few. The famous Copenhagen School, with all these Nobel Prize winners and whatnot, after all, was a circle where participated practically all the leaders in physics globally. They came and went, some stayed for a long time, like Kramers, like Heaviside. Some came and went, like Frank and Hertz and Cockcroft and Lawrence and Fermi. So it was an amazing opportunity at the time to go to this theoretical physics institute headed by Niels Bohr, where all these people came. My first reaction after a year or so was almost one of depression. Because when you are sharing daily life with all these people, because it was a family almost. Bohr lived there with his delightful wife. Both of them came to be very close friends of my wife and mine until their death. And they lived there with their children. Two of them about my age. And we were invited there, and we were together for lunch and for coffee, and we spent free time together. And even such a youngster as I and my contemporaries were accepted in this circle. And to an amazing degree, we were allowed to participate in discussions and meetings, provided that we didn't say anything at all unless it was really to the point. Banal statements, repetitive statements were not allowed, not even by the illuminaries. Why did you come into a state of depression and thinking as I did that maybe I could not manage a career as I had hoped? How can you share daily life with such people of a level of intelligence and intellectual activity that we did not even approach without thinking that it would be impossible for you to work in theoretical sciences, physics, and chemistry, that could in any way give you a career? How could you possibly believe that you could do that? And this was, in a way, if I look back, a very healthy thing, because you were exposed to a climate at Bohr's Institute and at the neighboring Brønsted Institute for Physical Chemistry. Mm-hmm. Think of it, two institutes, neighbors, with some of the top people in physics and in chemistry. How could you think that you could manage, so to speak? Well, anyhow, I started, got good friends with many of these people. My later wife joined in the circle. We were together. We got to know very well. We got to know Niels Bohr, of course, Brønsted, who was not so easy to really understand. The students of my year were lucky to establish a very good relation with Brønsted. And so we got to know these two, got to know very well the Danes working there, like Jacobsen, Bjørke, Møller, and Langsted, who really made their mark. And we got a very close friendship, lasted for years and years, with Hevesy, his family, with Cockcroft, his family. We got to know Kramers, and Lawrence, Teller, Blachek, who by the way was not a Nobel Prize winner, he should have had it. Brønsted also was not a Nobel Prize winner, because because the one in Sweden who was one of the main advisors to the committee for the Nobel Award, he decided to give the Nobel Prize to himself. I can say that because nobody would remember him today. Mm-hmm. Whereas Bronsted, of course, is very well remembered by all of us. Then we got to know the Capitas, whom we spent, have friendship with, also the young ones, ever till the two of them died. We got to know very well Gamow, who is not remembered today, although he was maybe the most outstanding intelligence you could imagine. At this time, always speaking about game theory in a way that today would make him illustrious, and many others. So, as I mentioned shortly yesterday evening, when I tried to explain to these people, and of course some of them were my teachers, and I had to perform to get on to graduate. Then I was interested in this interface between physics and chemistry that today all of us call catalysis. But at the time, really, I was thinking more in terms of what you could call materials science. Also because of what I started to say, because in a way what you could limit yourself to think about was to understand materials, not necessarily processes taking on going on material surfaces. Then, for instance, said the whole institute would be very happy to help me with this. And he himself at the time, and this is very interesting observation, without forgetting his focus on atomic physics, he had come to think that the time was right to also study material science, solid-state physics, and maybe even surface physics. Mm-hmm. Teller was very interested in surface physics and understood me well, but he felt that with the enormous progress made in theoretical physics, and even quantum mechanics, and he and Dirac were both of them talk a lot about quantum chemistry. With the enormous progress, it should be relatively easy to understand materials and even to understand catalysts. And he did not see this desire to try and understand the fundamentals to explain what you observed. He did not think that was much of a job, that should be relatively easy. To repeat what I said yesterday, one can be sick and tired of every time you are present at a conference and this one, half of the speakers say that, related to catalysis of course, half of the speakers say that the time is coming, maybe just around the corner, when we can explain everything ex priori from fundamentals. It certainly seemed in the mid-30s to some people, like the ones I mentioned, Otto Kockloff, for instance, Fermi, others, that it should be relatively easy to understand materials and maybe even catalysts. It was just around the corner to explain everything from first principles. Now we can hear during this conference so many say that partly to maybe make their speech and their own work more interesting, also to fundraisers, that it's just the time is approaching, it's around the corner when it takes on set. Now, so as I said, the board said that they would do everything to help me, and others said the same, thinking that it was a small task in a way. And of course you can't, you should not misunderstand what I'm saying. Because if you think of what had been achieved then, and what was being achieved, of tremendous, unbelievable efforts to understand the matter in ever greater details from Bohr's atomic of the hydrogen model down to all the sub-particles, sub-neutrons and what have you, positrons and so on. Then of course saw the result of efforts that were intellectually extremely demanding, that was as to tools to be used, experimental tools, extremely demanding and costly. And therefore you can understand that these people thought that relatively primitive things we needed to understand how to make a catalyst that was made in very, very primitive equipment, costing dollars when their equipment costed millions, and requiring what they considered chemistry, kitchen work, where they were talking about accelerators of extreme cost and complexity. Then you can't misunderstand. You should not think that I'm trying to criticize anything or send, at these times, of course, the metaphysics was coming. So I think it was Teller who said to me that, well, I'm not sure about that though, that what you do in a kitchen, we do in accelerators costing billions. Now, I cannot remember exactly when the advent came of the first very big physics machines, but of course it was underway in a large scale already then. Then of course you also had the advent at that time of isotopes. Urey had made his discovery of deuterium. I happened to know him a little bit, and I knew some of his assistants very well. Hevesy and others had done their work on isotopes, radioactive isotopes, and had shown how these results of metaphysics were very, very useful for also chemical analysis. If you take as an example, if you wanted to understand how molecules were fitted together, how they were bound together, for instance, organic molecules, even simple ones, then with the means we used at that time, like molecular spectroscopy, which was of interest, Rahman had done his work, and for that was interesting. Then when you studied spectra there, it was sometimes difficult to say which line were related to what sort of vibrations or rotations in the molecule. But you could, by putting deuterium into a molecule and see how these lines moved, you could determine which line related to which sort of vibrations, which was a big step forward in understanding, shall we say, molecules in on the atomic scale level, or whatever you would like to call it. And therefore that was also something which caught the interest of everybody. And as I could do a little bit, very, very little bit, very modest work related to some of these things, particularly with Hevesy, then we got good friends, and many of these people, including Hevesy, supported me, understood that what I wanted to do deserved their interest, and that the physicists maybe could contribute more than they had thought to chemistry, and as some of them accepted, also as to the understanding of chemistry and nature. Many of them also understood better than maybe earlier years, that without an understanding of chemistry, you had no possibility of understanding biology, and you had no possibility of understanding nature, whether the dead or the living nature. And therefore, more and more physicists were interested in, took initiative themselves, of course. I'm vastly exaggerating my role, but let me say what I've said very much is what an observer can say. Therefore, to cut it short, it was possible to get some, shall we say, relationships, working relationships established. Now, what did I want? I wanted, when I was employed in industry, I wanted to use catalysis. This industry used a lot of nickel hydrogenation processes, and I wanted in this industry, where they gave me the job of putting together a research section, I wanted to understand the fundamentals, to better understand how to make the catalyst, and how to better understand how to use them, and how to better understand how to design units using these catalysts, industrial units. That's what I wanted when I worked for some years before the war, 3-4 years in industry. And during this time, I very much wanted to focus more and more on general catalysis, not just hydrogenation and nickel or platinum or whatever we used, Atkins antispinals and things like that. You know who Mark T. Atkins, whom I'm thinking about, a very fine person. I was not necessarily interested in having my own outfit, but I was more interested in the area in which I could work than in being my own master or working in a company or an institute. I really wanted to work in a university institute. But in the years before the war, also when I had graduated, had to find out what to do. In Denmark there was very, very little money for research. There was very, very little money for experimental equipment, and even the universities had very little. The only one who had something was Niels Bohr and the Rockefeller Institute of Cokes, the biologist. And that left very little money to other sectors of the sciences. Let me, before coming to the time when I started off, say a little bit about how the situation was in industry as I observed it at the time. Because of my occupation, I had a lot of duties to collaborate with industries, what have you, in many countries, and therefore I had the possibility to observe how industry in many countries worked. And I don't know what really one would think about it today, but the fact was that in very few industrial companies did you have a real research unit. And where you had a research unit, like in Germany, for instance, as I explained, it was to a large extent my fields, it was to a large extent this matrix kitchen business. So the industry had very little interest in forschung, in research, in the way we understand it today in the society. And many of them didn't even have a research department. And very, very few had activities on what you could call university level, and hardly anybody had an ongoing relation with the universities, which all of us thought had just one duty, namely to produce candidates, engineers, what have you, for the industry and other and public activities. So it was very, very rarely that you really found in business, industry and other businesses, an interest in the fundamental basis for industrialization and progress in industry. Now, when war came, I could not continue my job in the industry and in Denmark, and therefore my wife and I wanted to come to the States, where we had many friends, and where, for many reasons, I could expect to have a good job, also because some of the things I had been involved in were of particular interest to some American companies, particularly in the chemical industry, and also in government. So when Denmark was occupied on the 9th of April 1940, the American ambassador came and said, no, he didn't come here. He informed us that there was a possibility that we could be flown out next day, and via the UK come to the States, where they had arranged for us to come, be accepted, and get some possibility to work. Oh, I have the time. We could not because our two children were critically ill with pneumonia, which was difficult to cure at the time, so we could not, so we stayed. And my wife felt that we better take the situation as it was, accepted that the war wouldn't be over tomorrow, and that I should do some work that could be useful for the future when peace came. We couldn't possibly think of working for the Germans. So we had the great privilege that we could, to a large extent, work for Swedish industries with which we had family relations, particularly with the so-called Wallenberg group. And the number one man at the time, Marcus Wallenberg, was a friend, was a close friend until he died. We worked together in many, many situations. That enabled us to do work in Sweden and back it up with work in Denmark. And in this context, it's interesting that you talk so much about the difficulties of collaboration between business industries and the universities. The Copenhagen Technical University opened the doors for me and the few colleagues I could hire, so to speak, to start this activity by giving us some laboratories in the university that we could install as we wanted to do work in catalysis. And at the time we also were thinking a little bit about biological work, particularly enzymes, because catalysis for industry and enzymes for biology, of course, are the same in a way. So it's amazing that what today is being discussed until you vomit everywhere about the relations between industry and universities was so easy for us in the 1940s, during the early years of the war, simply because the university gave us some laboratories, easy access to facilities. We just had to pay the cash cost of what we did, and I have always thought that this is the way in which universities can really help industry, not with all these agreements to do this or that, that have people from the university participate in some projects by also having an economic interest, a financial interest. I've always thought there's this idea of opening the doors to people who, for their own monies, would work and so on, but would have the availability of not only the physical facilities, but of the of advice by the university people. I always thought that that is a very desirable alternative for collaboration. Now, what about then the company? We were at an early time able to have quite a few collaborators rapidly growing number in Sweden, and quite a number in Denmark. So already during the war, we could establish a laboratory near Copenhagen of our own, with a room for some 25 to 50 people. It's strange to recall that Bohr was the one who came to inaugurate this laboratory of ours. And there we very, very much strongly focused on catalysis. On catalysis from fundamental studies, which we already could undertake to a considerable degree. In this, we could afford it. And to engineering and to industrial activities. Now, we had one mission, or several missions. One mission was the main one, that we wanted to have a company which was anchored on fundamental studies, scientific studies, if you dare take such a strong word in your mouth, and derived their knowledge from fundamental studies, and when possible, use the knowledge for business to create new catalysts, to manufacture them, to sell them, to develop new processes, to sell them, to do engineering, design, and what have you. And so we wanted to show that one could have a business anchored on fundamentals and supporting itself by business activities to an extent that would permit you to grow in reasonable proportions your fundamental scientific studies and your, shall we say, gainful industrial work. This was our mission, to show that. It's still our mission, one of the main ones. The other one, of course, was that we wanted to have a company where it was nice to work together, nice to come, nice to go home in the evening, nice to retire, because nothing as important if you have a company as to make sure that your colleagues like to work there, but even more, you might say, that those who retire can think back upon years that they liked. It's awful to think of people who have to leave their work for one reason or another and then think back on the place where they, or places where they work, with bitterness.
Yeah.
That should not be allowed by any business management to not to de-emphasize that. And therefore, I've always been shocked when you can stand up at a general assembly meeting in a company on the exchange and tell the assembled stockholders that you have the pleasant knowledge, the pleasant news to tell them that it's possible to reduce staff by so and so many thousand, and then they get a standing ovation. Well, that's an exaggeration, I'm afraid. But
no.
Anyhow, these are, of course, were the two main principles for us. Now, why did we select catalysis when you have this mission? Well, simply because all of us who worked together at the early times, and some of them are very well known, like Anders Nielsen, like Jorgen Kjær, and Hans Bolbro, people who made their mark also in international scientific literature. Data, of course, we have had many, many more, but I've just mentioned those from the early years. And why did we select Catanuses if we had this mission? Because we believed that Catanuses would very rapidly gain importance. We believed that we had the background in physics and in chemistry. Most of us were chemical engineers or university chemists. Some of us had studied physics also. A few later, came later, were physicists. And we believed that there would be a rapid increase, so that there would be a growing demand for new knowledge, for new catalysts, for new processes. And we believed that we could gain money to allow us to survive, to develop, to finance development, and to finance science, scientific work, by selling catalysts, one leg, by selling processes, another leg, by selling hardware for industrial plants using catalysis, a third leg. And therefore we thought that this selection of catalysis was well, what shall we say, justified also by, shall we say, narrow considerations of the economies of what we did. We did not have much money. We did have a little start money, but we did not have substantial sums, so we could not embark upon a burning of money research program as so many people do today if they have access to such risk money. I'm not criticizing it, to the contrary. Now, what was then the situation? The situation was that a growing number of scientists around the world had done amazing work in catalysis. Quite a few had developed new catalysts by one way or another, by their matrix studies or by more theoretical considerations, and you were already having, besides established catalytic industries like sulfuric acid, ammonia, fat hardening and things like that, you had the embryo situation with monomers. By the way, my colleagues and I in 1938 were the first to make polyethylene, and we did it by a peculiar process. When we asked the managing director, I was employed at that time, where we could patent it, he said, absolutely not. But we were the first to make polyethylene through a catalytic process. Anyhow, that's besides the point, but not completely, because we were impressed by the advent of monomers. We were thinking that all this would not be possible without catalysis. We were impressed by the importance of some new process coming into the refinery. Kukri had already made his mark, and we were impressed by the work that was done in different scientific institutes. To mention a little bit against my desire, the Kaiser Wilhelm von zu Haber and similar institutes in Germany, Imperial College and Cambridge, other places in England, and over here also. So from that was the beginning. Now, was one thing that was, you might say, peculiar and interesting, because before the war, at least in the early 30s when I started, the term process engineering hardly existed. It had no meaning. The way in which people designed chemical plants, flow plants, catalytically based plants, was, to say the least, very peculiar. The understanding of flow sheets was hardly existing. So process engineering did not really exist. It was not taught in technical universities. In England, for instance, it wasn't taught at all. Even after the war, it wasn't taught. The first place where it was taught was in Leeds, within the collaborate. So to a large extent, the discipline of process engineering, flow sheeting, innovative flow sheet analysis and engineering, to a large extent, came from over here. So after the war, many of us in Europe were amazed to see how much progress has been made in the States to come from fundamentals, whether they were kitchen fundamentals or real fundamentals, to process, to process engineering, to justified method for doing flow sheets, material balances, understanding kinetics, heat exchange, and all that business, and also to start understanding how different catalytic reactors could be made. It was surprising to see to what